Episode number 226. In the place of the foul dish of haricot beans made its appearance, an enormous dish, in which some bones of mutton that at first sight one might have believed to have some meat on them pretended to show themselves. But the clerks were not the dupes of this deceit, and their lugubrious looks settled down into resigned countenances. MME. Coquona distributed this dish to the young men with the moderation of a good housewife. The time for wine came. M. Coquona poured from a very small stone bottle the third of a glass for each of the young men, served himself in about the same proportion, and passed the bottle to Porthos and MME. Coquona. The young men filled up the third of a glass with water, then, when they had drunk half the glass, they filled it up again, and continued to do so. This brought them, by the end of the repast, to swallowing a drink, which from the color of the ruby had passed to that of a pale topaz. Porthos ate his wing of the fowl timidly, and shuddered when he felt the knee of the procurator's wife under the table, as it came in search of his. He also drank half a glass of this sparingly served wine, and found it to be nothing but that horrible Montreuil, the terror of all expert palates. M. Coquonad saw him swallowing this wine undiluted, and sighed deeply. "Will you eat any of these beans, cousin Porthos?" said MME. Coquonad, in that tone, which says, "Take my advice, don't touch them." "Devil take me, if I taste one of them," murmured Porthos to himself, and then said aloud, "Thank you, my cousin, I am no longer hungry." There was silence. Porthos could hardly keep his countenance. The procurator repeated several times, "Ah, Madame Coquonad, accept my compliments. Your dinner has been a real feast. Lord, how I have eaten." M. Coquonad had eaten his soup, the black feet of the fowl, and the only mutton bone on which there was the least appearance of meat. Porthos fancied they were mystifying him, and began to curl his moustache and knit his eyebrows, but the knee of MME. Coquona gently advised him to be patient. This silence, and this interruption in serving, which were unintelligible to Porthos, had, on the contrary, a terrible meaning for the clerks. Upon a look from the procurator, accompanied by a smile from MME. Coquona, they rose slowly from the table, folded their napkins more slowly still, bowed, and retired. "Go, young men. Go and promote digestion by working," said the procurator, gravely. "The clerk's gone, MME." Coquona rose, and took from a buffet a piece of cheese, some preserved quinces, and a cake, which she had herself made of almonds, and honey. M. Coquona knit his eyebrows, because there were too many good things. Porthos bit his lips, because he saw not the way with the dine. He looked to see if the dish of beans was still there. The dish of beans had disappeared. "A positive feast," cried M. Coquonad, turning about in his chair. "A real feast, apples epulorum. Lucullus dines with Lucullus."